So I'd like to talk about why the police are accountable and why the police could be more accountable to the public. So I'd like to speak to the underlying rationale for that. And then I'd like to talk a little bit about the nature of policing that requires counteractive measures in order to sustain professionalism. And then I'm going to talk for about one slide on the results of our three-year project on professionalism in policing. So I want to begin by actually using Robert Peel again. Kelly has already alluded to the importance of Robert Peel. So in 1829, he mentioned that the ability of the police to perform their duties is dependent upon public approval of police actions. So what I'd like to do is to explore why that approval is so important. He more or less ties it to police being effective, but I think there's another reason as well. And that other reason, I think we can anchor in the nature of a profession. So tonight I'm going to argue that policing is a profession. I know that many of my academic colleagues don't believe it is, but I think it is for very good reasons. So if we look at what a profession is, it essentially is an occupation that structures itself to ensure it has the public trust. So now the interesting question is, well, why? What is so important about having the public trust? So we could say, for instance, that the private sector also needs the public trust, but it doesn't need it as much as, say, law, medicine, and policing. So why is that? So if we try and answer that question, we can see if we look at historically the three older professions, law, medicine, and of course those people who taught, or I should say actually it was law and religion, they were the only two learned professions. And of course the people who taught them were the third profession, academia. And so if you look at what they were providing and continue to provide an indispensable public good. And so whenever we have people providing an indispensable public good, for instance, like medicine, the judiciary, and I would argue also policing, the public is concerned about the quality of that service being delivered, and rightly so. Now, add another complicating factor. Professions have practitioners who have a high degree of autonomy in exercising their judgment about the delivery of that public good. So I'll give you an example. If I go in to see a doctor and I think I've got a brain tumor, and I tell him that I don't want my doctor to go through a whole bunch of reference books. I don't want him to walk out of the office and talk to all of his colleagues. I want him to be able to know what are the appropriate tests to give me as quickly as possible, and what's the diagnosis I need as quickly as possible. How can I get help as quickly as possible? So professions have a lot of autonomy, and we give them that autonomy on the basis of the training, the education they have, and their immersion in socialized, their immersion in the values of the profession. So if you think of medicine and law, 7, 8 years if you specialize in medicine, another few years. So they will spend sometimes 10 to 12 years just immersing themselves in medicine before they actually practice. So those two conditions together, an important public service delivered under conditions of high autonomy, we have every right to be concerned that they're doing so in a way in which we can trust the delivery of those goods. So now the question is policing a profession? Do they provide an indispensable public good? Well, I would argue that they do, that they provide the conditions under which we are safe and secure, free from assault, free from fraud, and so on. Now, of course, that would be a perfect world, but I was told by the chair of the police service, the Calgary Police Service Commission, that in the last 3 years, Calgary has reduced crime by 35%. So that's huge. When we feel that we're not threatened, when we feel secure, we can learn to cooperate as individuals, as communities, and do much more productive things than we could without that. So then the second question is, do constables have a great deal of autonomy? And yes, they do, and we're grateful for that fact. So we all break the law probably every day. I certainly know I do, because whenever I get in the car, I never do the speed limit. So if I'm doing 1 kilometer over the speed limit, I would be very surprised if a constable pulled me over and gave me a ticket. So they use their discretion, they use their judgment, and when it's appropriate, to either fine me, or fine me for a lesser offense, or simply warn me, and I've had them all. On the other hand, there may be situations where they may think it appropriate to arrest someone. But on the other hand, by arresting someone, let me give you an example. Say that we're in Vancouver, someone, a foreign national, is found committing a minor offense while he's in Vancouver, and the police officer realizes, okay, if I charge that person, we're going to have to detain him in Canada. It's going to have serious consequences on his employment prospects. He's probably going to have difficulty re-entering his country. He's certainly going to miss his ship. Is it worth all that? Right? So police officers exercise their judgment all the time, and we're grateful that they do, because if they applied the letter of the law, the communities would be in an uproar. And then finally, do police agencies actually structure themselves as professions do, in a way to secure public trust? And the way I think they do, there is no question in my mind that they do. They have all kinds of internal accountability structures to ensure that they can monitor appropriate police performance. They do so by having very rigorous standards in recruitment, having very rigorous training, having very good supervision, as our research project discovered. And then after that, integration through field mentoring and so on. They usually, most police agencies in Canada as well anyway, are developing what we call an early intervention system. It's a means of tracking police officers who may be using excessive use of force, or maybe charging too frequently people for assaulting a police officer, which is another indication which they may be using excessive force. In some cases, those early intervention systems even track the amount of overtime that police officers are engaging in, because we know that overtime and fatigue, we know that overtime is related to fatigue, fatigue is related to stress, and stress is related to poor judgment. And if you're a police officer, poor judgment has serious ramifications, including for their careers. So there are a variety of ways in which they hold themselves accountable, and what I'm going to do is argue that there are other ways, too, in which they could be more transparent and, in fact, more open. So, but first of all, in the study that we conducted, we found that many of the values that govern policing were actually poorly defined. I don't think Canada as a community yet, as a policing community, has actually defined its core values in a way which gives them some meat, and in a way which defines them so that it can generate shared expectations of behavior. I think we've gotten to that group yet. But when we try to look at professionalism, we first had to try and figure out what it meant. And as I said, one of the ways I did that was going back and looking at what a profession is. So if a profession is an occupation which structures itself to deserve the public trust, then professionalism is conduct befitting the public trust. That's what we expect of police officers. Now, if you unpack that for police officers, that means, first of all, compliance with legislation, compliance with the Police Services Act, and then compliance with organizational policies. And then finally, and what really interested me, is compliance with the core values of policing. Because we can usually do a very good job of tracking people who break the rules, but we find it much more difficult to keep track of people who are making errors of judgment and breaching core values. So that was what we tried to do. So before I talk about why we thought this was an important project, it's important to note that our results are actually, I think for the most part, they're applicable to the public sector too. They're applicable to private sector organizations. But we never would have gotten into a private sector organization, right? I mean, no one wants to have their ethics probed, and no one wants to run the possibility that even if it is, it's going to be published and other people are going to know about it. So when the CACP approached me with this project, it was an amazing opportunity to actually look at standards of ethical behavior and how people meet them. However, one thing is very, very different about policing from other private and public sector organizations, and that is to say that they work in a very corrosive environment. They look at accidents frequently, where there is horrible disfiguration. They meet victims of crime who have suffered assaults, domestic abuse, rape, family members of those victims. They will often be in areas where they are treated with not only verbal abuse, but physical abuse. The kind of interventions that they do in their daily calls are not the kind of interventions where people are going to thank them for doing a good job. The people they deal with are under conditions of stress, they're highly emotional, they're difficult to deal with. And maybe, and often it happens actually, a couple of months later, they'll think that the police did a very good job, and they may actually try and contact the police service to let them know that. But seldom the individual officer is going to get that kind of feedback that we often get in our jobs. The other issue, of course, is, you know, they deal with the drug culture, the homeless, many mentally ill. But they're also targeted by organized crime, who want to be able to turn them so that organized crime can benefit from them. And so that's also something that they have to deal with. So it's the nature of the job. We can't change that, but what can we do to possibly ameliorate those conditions? So there has been a fair amount of research done on corruption, but in fact none done on sustaining a person's commitment to do their job, whether it's in the public sector, private sector, and policing. And yet, it seems to me this is really the most important, because we know that police get very good recruits, very enthusiastic, really committed to policing. So what happens down the road when they begin to lose that commitment? And it happens in the public sector, private sector as well. We know that around 15 years service, when all of a sudden now we're raising children, we've got other things to do, we were passed over for promotion, blah, 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 blah. People are just not as committed to the organization as they once were. In policing, that's actually quite serious when they become disengaged. And so we know from previous research that they can become disengaged from the judiciary. Perhaps one of their colleagues was shot, injured, killed by a criminal, and they thought that the courts didn't deal with that appropriately. Then they begin to lose faith in the court system. They can become disengaged from their agency if they believe that the agency is not standing up for what they've done, if it's not demonstrating and promoting values and ethics, if it's not defending the police officers or doing a good job, they can also become disengaged. And one of the really trying and difficult aspects of policing is actually becoming disengaged from the communities they serve. And so what begins to happen is when they become disengaged from their communities, then they become more engaged with a police subculture, which has some positive attributes, but also some serious negative ones. So whenever the police regard the community as us against them, then we have some serious concerns. So what we see and what we can see in the research now is that as soon as we have this kind of disengagement, it leads to cynicism, where we are suspicious of the motives of others, and we think that really nobody's out to do anything for me or nobody's out to do anything for the community. Everybody's out to strive for their own career, to strive for their own benefits. We're all self-interested sons of bitches and so on. So once that happens, we know now since 2006 that cynicism is related to unprofessional conduct. Okay, so if it's related to unprofessional conduct, then now we're going down a road where people then begin to morally disengage. And there are signs of that. You can tell by the language they use, you can tell by the utterances they have. A good example in Saskatoon, I'm sure you've heard about the Starlight Tours, where Aboriginals were just taken outside of the town and dropped in fields. So whenever you see that kind of language, then you realize that police officers all of a sudden now are trying to distance themselves from those people, trying to dehumanize them and make their to justify what they're doing. And obviously the military have been doing that for some time. Right? We talk about collateral damage instead of the people who lose their lives as a result of the shelling and so on. So once we see moral disengagement, and I have to give an aside here. I sometimes do these interactive sessions with various police agencies, and I ask them to sort of identify the signs of moral disengagement. So I was in Jamaica, and I was doing some work with the senior executive members of the Jamaican Constabulary. So when I asked this question, of course, I'm thinking I'm going to get a very, very accurate description of these psychological attributes of withdrawal. I said, so what are the signs of moral disengagement? And they said, they have a big house. They have a big house, and they drive really expensive cars. It's okay, that works. Once we have moral disengagement, then we begin to see officers turning a blind eye to other people, or to other officers, engaging in unprofessional conduct. So we call that acts of omission. And then from there, it's not too long before they're not only turning a blind eye, but they're partnering and engaging in those acts of commission. So why not try and just start at the top here and address the causes of disengagement? So that's what our project tried to identify. So I know this is about police ethics, and you're going to think, okay, I haven't really talked about the sorts of nasty things they do, so this slide is in there. I really want to talk about actually preventing and sustaining professionalism and preventing misconduct. But so here would be an example of, say, from minor breaches to very egregious breaches. So breaches of core police values, and of course that's what really interests me. Violations of regulations, excessive use of force, noble cause corruption. And noble cause corruption is quite interesting because for a long time in the police literature we thought of corruption as just personal gain. So police officers would abuse their authority in order to pad their own wallets, engaging in graft and bribery and other corrupt practices. But actually, there's a lot of, or some corruption, let me put it this way, that has to deal with the fact that they are overcommitted to policing. They want to catch those bad guys. And if it means tampering with evidence, or planting evidence, or fabricating witnesses, then they'll do that to make sure that bad guys get behind bars. So that's a different kind of corruption, and it usually is due to overcommitment and also a disengagement from the police agency regulations, a disengagement as well from the judiciary that would cause that. And then finally, of course, the more traditional form of corruption. So when we started our survey, the CACP Ethics Committee was really interested in trying to identify the policies or programs or practices that sustain this commitment to professionalism. So I said, okay, we'll go with that. And I did 80 interviews across the country. And in one of those interviews, I discovered that one agency had 1,200 policies. So I scribbled that out. Okay, from now on, we're just going to be looking at practices and programs because it's just an impossible job to try and work with that number. So as it turned out, I'll give you an overview of what we found. And I know this looks like a complicated slide, but let me walk you through it. So if you look at the left-hand portion of this, your left-hand portion of the slide, this is the traditional way police agencies thought that they were guiding discretionary judgment. And let me just clarify again, discretionary judgment is really their autonomous behavior, right? Their decisions to fine or not fine. And one of the wonderful books that I read described this dimension quite accurately, I think, as the ethical dimension of policing. Right? This is where they make decisions using their own judgment. That's really the ethical dimension of policing. I found that apropos. So then how do we guide it? How do we guide their discretionary judgment? Well, traditionally, this is what we thought. Right? We set up appropriate legislation, like the Police Services Act. So by the way, Jamaica doesn't even have any legislation governing police regulations, and I mean they're really impoverished in the sense of how they can strengthen police professionalism. Have many challenges. So legislation by far very, very important. And then the organizations themselves, agencies themselves, can come up with specific policies about say use of force or chasing suspects, high-speed chases, for example, through the city, so they can decide to disallow them or not. So they can come up with various organizational policies. And then, finally, the rules that derive from those policies. And then we think, okay, so now we're guiding formal decision-making, and that decision-making then is going to help guide the discretionary judgment. Well, what we found is that it doesn't. What it does is it sets the parameters within which discretionary judgment is exercised. Okay? So on one side, right, you can't break legislation, or on the other side, you can't break policy. But within that, you still have a lot of room to make decisions. So we're really not guiding their discretionary judgment. And so around the 1989, I think it was 1991, in the United States, they introduced the federal sentencing guidelines, and this actually began to hold corporations accountable for ethical violations. It spawned a whole industry of ethics officers. It spawned a whole attempt to try and guide discretionary judgment as well as compliance. So for the last 20 years or so, we've seen this kind of explosion of articulating organizational values and hoping that those organizational values will guide discretionary judgment. Well, and truth be told, most organizations really do a very poor job of defining core values, which are in effect all the time, such as respect, for example. Police have to respect criminals if they spit on them, if they abuse them, whatever. You still have to respect their legal rights. Respect is not something you can put in your back pocket and pull it out tomorrow. Whereas loyalty, for example, is, right? We're only loyal to ethically justified direction, as the Nazis at the Nuremberg war crimes found out. So in terms of guiding this, we haven't done a very good job at identifying core values, I haven't done a very good job at defining them, and we haven't done a very good job at sharing with the expectations associated with them. So they thought if they had done that, it would guide discretionary judgment. Well, what we found that is, even if those organizational values are well-defined, even if they're core values, that it still doesn't guide their discretionary judgment. We found that it's filtered through management practices. So in other words, what they're going to be doing is they're going to be looking at their senior officers, and they're going to be asking them, well, you know, the job promotion system here, or the job decisions here, are really unfair and unbiased. And you don't care about my opinions. You know, I do these surveys all the time, but no one provides me any feedback. No one tells me what we're doing to try and improve things. Or they'll say, you know what, I don't know what how our leaders stand on values and ethics. I don't know them. You know, they don't seem to be doing a very good job of promoting it, because when someone breaches organizational values, and we've got managers that bully us and harass us, and no one does anything about it, so all of a sudden they're saying, you know what, these values of fairness and respect and so on, well, I don't see them. I don't see them. I don't see them practiced in the organization to which I belong. So why should I care about them? Right? Senior managers don't. Now, we found, however, that those management practices are only moderately related to professionalism, only moderately related to integrity. And that's because a person's personal character is still quite strong. So we find that even police operating in a corrosive environment, and sometimes operating in a corrosive environment even in their police agency, still want to do the right thing and still do a very good job of doing that. But it does begin the process of disengagement, the process of disengagement from their agency, or the process of disengagement from their community. And so that's something that we need to address. And so we found actually that there were about six management practices that really drive this commitment to engagement, this commitment to doing the right thing. And many of those, in fact, I think all of those six drivers would be relevant in the public sector as well as in the private sector. So we found, for example, that organizational support was number one. If they felt they were supported by the organization cared about their well-being, cared about their opinions, did something about it, that was really important. The second one was ethical leadership. If they thought that their senior leaders were promoting values and ethics, managing values and ethics for success, embedding ethics into job decisions, embedding ethics into formal decision making, strategic planning, and so on, then that was a major driver. The third driver we found was actually job decisions itself, which we call procedural justice. So if they think that the job decisions are unfair and unbiased, then they're not going to be as committed. The fourth driver we found was internalization of organizational values. So if they have good values and they're well practiced, then that was a driver of professionalism as well. And we found, so one of the ramifications for that, for example, is that in ethics training, we need to talk about police values a lot more than we do. And finally, we found that supportive supervision was an important driver. And we also found that community respect was, and that's the only management practice, or that's the only driver we found wasn't a management practice. It's something that the community supports them or not, and if the community supports them, that's a driver of professionalism. Okay, so I certainly don't have time to go into the results, but what I do want to say very quickly, in the next 20 seconds, because I know I'm going to be cut off at 30, is that what I would like to see is police agencies starting to blur the line between operations and the other areas in which they report. So for example, usually we say that police boards would never interfere with police operations. That's something for the chief and the police. They have the technical expertise, they have the knowledge, they have the know-how, let's let them do it. But I'll just say quickly that we need to be more involved, because we want to know what they're doing to mitigate ethical risk. We want to know what they're doing to sustain professionalism. And all we have to do is apply one single test. That is, do you have any of your operations right now, or any major events that are coming up, where you believe that civil rights may be impacted, that charter rights may be impacted, or there's a potential for escalation of conflict? Is that happening around the corner? That's a simple question to ask, but it's one that begins to engage policing much more with the community to prevent possible breaches of our charter rights. I think I'm going to wrap up there by just saying one last thing. There are other things I can recommend with respect to this greater accountability and transparency, but I'd just like to take, and I'm now actually 9 seconds over, I'd like to take the chance or this opportunity to thank the 31 police agencies involved across the country in our project. We had 10,200 responses, so we had zero margin of error, and a major study which hasn't been done before. It's triple the largest data set I've ever seen in ethics in policing. So Canada, I think, has really done a fantastic job in taking the lead here, and it wouldn't have happened if Canadian police agencies hadn't stood behind the project. And last but not least, the Shelton and Schumer Foundation. Without their support, without their financial support, impossible to do this. Impossible to do this project. It turned out to be a 3-year project instead of a 1-year project, and escalated in terms of commitment and costs, and they were wonderful supporters of this project.